Hello students, welcome to E Padasala. I am Dr. S. Gayatri Devi, working as assistant professor in the Department of Psychology, Avinash Lingam University. The topic which we are going to discuss is about directive or non-directive counselling. Traditionally, Indians use directive counselling rather than non-directive counselling. Since we are more of people who could tell others what to do rather make people take their own decisions. This has more to do with a patriarchal society that believed in helping people realize that elders should command and youngsters should be listening to them. Therefore, directing people to do that would best suit them and help them to achieve the goal. Since elders or seniors were considered to have undergone such a situation and they would have had success, that it is believed that it will work for others too. Therefore, non-directive counseling, which seldom use and it is considered as not to be reliable and sometimes might not give hope to put their foot forward and succeed. Thus, directive counseling is considered to be best tool for counseling. Now we'll see what is definition for counseling. Shastam and Brahma defined counseling as a purposeful reciprocal relationship between two people in which one, a trained person, helps the other to change himself or his environment. Now we'll see what is directive counseling is. Directive counseling is otherwise known as counselor-centered or prescriptive counseling. In this counseling type, the counselor plays an important role. The major goal is to replace the irrational behavior of the client to rational behavior. The counselor avoids dictatorial advice during the counseling process. The counselor plans for the client how to proceed the counseling process, identifying and analyzing the problem and finding out various options for the problem. Williamson stated that directive counseling will be helpful when the problems related to education and vocational adjustment. Educational and vocational guidance needs personality dynamics and interpersonal relationship, so it is highly useful in career guidance. Now we will see what is features of directive counseling. Directive counseling features are: the counselor plays a more active role than the client. Second, the client makes the decision, but the counselor helps him to take the appropriate decision based on the diagnosis. Third point, the counselor helps the client to think rationally by informing, explaining, interpreting, and advising. Steps of directive counseling. Williamson has given 6 steps in directive counseling. The first step is analysis. In this step, the information from the client will be collected by structured interviews, case history methods, interaction with family members, friends, etc. Second point, synthesis. After the data collection, information is organized in logical manner and analyzes it based on client's qualification, assets, potentials, liability, adjustment, cultural background, habits, etc. Third point is diagnosis. It consists of the interpretation of the data in relation to the nature of the problem and the causes for it. Fourth point is prognosis. In this step, a prediction is made about the future development of the problem. Fifth point is counseling. In counseling process, the client will be taught to adjust and readjust to the problem. The client's interest and attitudes will be considered. The counselor will emphasize the client to develop positive goals, and when the client attains it, then the client will be highly self-motivated. Sixth point, follow-up. Follow-up is extremely important. The client may be able to solve the immediate problems, but new problems may occur or the original problems may reoccur. Follow-up is extremely necessary. The counselor should make the client to understand and accept the strength and also his weakness and faults. Now we'll see what is directive counselling. Directive counselling revolves around the counselor. The counselor tries to maintain good relations with the client and try to give assistance whenever necessary. The counselor is active and expresses his ideas and attitudes independently and evaluates the expressions of the client. Directive teaching is the core in all the cognitive approaches. Rational emotive behavior therapy is previously known as rational therapy and rational emotive therapy. Rational emotive behavior therapy basic hypothesis is that client's emotions stem mainly from the beliefs, evaluations, interpretations, and reactions to life situations. In the therapeutic process, clients learn skills that give them the tools to identify and dispute irrational beliefs that have been acquired and self-constructed and maintained by self-indoctrination. They learn how to replace such ineffective ways of thinking with effective and rational cognitions. As a result, client understands the emotional reactions to situations, work through the target problems, and establishes the therapeutic goals. Now we'll see what is the basic assumptions of directive counseling are. According to Willey, the basic assumptions of directive counseling are: the first point, competency in giving advice. The counselor possesses the best training, experience, and information. He is more competent to give solutions to the problem. The next point is counseling as an intellectual process. A client's intellectual is not destroyed as a result of maladjustment. Hence, counseling is primarily an intellectual process, and it stresses upon the intellectual aspects of the client instead of emotional aspects of his personality. Next point, counseling objectives as problem solving situation. The objective of counseling is achieved through problem solving situation. Next point, client's incapability of solving the process. The counselor does not possess the capability for solving the problem always. We will see what is the role of counselor in directive counseling. The counselor plays the vital role in the counseling process. He is the pivot of the process and the leader of the situation. The counselor does most of the talking problems and the client is not the focus. The client works under the counselor and not with him. The counselor tries to direct the thinking of the client by informing, explaining, interpreting, and sometimes advising also. The counselor collects all possible information about the client and analyzes them for an adequate understanding. He summarizes and organizes the data so as to understand the abilities and limitations, adjustment and maladjustment of the client. He formulates conclusions about the nature and causes of the problems and predicts for the future development. Now we will see what is the advantages of directive counseling. The advantages of directive counseling are: it saves time, it focuses on the problem and not the person, the counselor can look the client directly, it focuses more on the intellectual aspects of the client rather than emotional aspect of the personality. Counselors are always available to help the client, which makes them feel very happy. Now we will see what is the limitations of directive counseling. In this process, the client is more dependent on the counselor. He will not be able to solve new problems of adjustment. Second point, if the client does not develop some attitude through experiences, he cannot make any decision by himself. Third point, the counselor fails in serving the client not to commit the mistakes in future. In directive counseling, The counselor initiates discussion or approaches the client based on a direct referral from another practitioner. In non-directive counseling, the client is aware of the problem and seeks help from the counselor. Clients tend to be far more likely to become defensive and resist problem solving under the conditions of directive counseling. For this reason, counselors using this method need to be especially sensitive to all verbal and non-verbal behaviors and to be supportive while attempting to explore the issue at hand. Directive counseling techniques are used for remedial counseling sessions to address poor performance when the client is unaware or unwilling to address it to themselves. Non-directive counseling is ordinarily the preferred counseling method when dealing with clients who need to plan and they set the goals for themselves. Now we'll see what is non-directive counseling is. There were four periods of counseling. The first period was during 1940s. American psychologist Carl Rogers developed non-directive counseling. The second period during 1950s, Rogers renamed his approach client-centered therapy to reflect its focus on the client rather than on non-directive methods. Central importance was given to the phenomenological world of the client. Rogers assumed that the best vantage point for logical world of the client. He assumed that the best vantage point for understanding how people behave was from their own internal frame of reference. He focused more explicitly on the actualizing tendency as a basic motivation force that leads to clients' change. The third period, during 1960, he published the book of On Becoming a Person. The focus of the approach was on the nature of becoming the self that one truly is. The fourth phase during 1970s and 1980s was marked by considerable expansion to education, industry, groups, conflict, resolution, and the search for world peace. Although the person-centered approach has been applied mainly to individual and group counseling, important areas of further application include education, family life, leadership and administration, organizational development, healthcare, cross-cultural and interracial activity, and international relations. It was during the late 1970s and most of the 1980s that Rogers directed his efforts toward applying the person-centered approach to politics, especially to the achievement of world peace. Previous psychological theories viewed human beings as inherently selfish and corrupt. For an example, Freud's theory focused on sexual and aggressive tendencies as the primary forces driving human behavior. The human potential movement defined human nature as inherently good. From its perspective, human behavior is motivated by a drive to achieve one's fullest potential. A basic assumption in the Rogerian client-centered point of view is that humans are basically rational, socialized, and realistic. Individuals, if their needs for positive regard from others and for positive self-regard are satisfied, possess an inherent tendency toward realizing their potential for growth and self-actualization. Counseling releases the potentials and capacities of the individual. One of the most important characteristics of the Rogerian theory is the relationship it suggests between the counselor and the client. The underlying assumption is that the client cannot be helped simply by listening to the knowledge the counselor possesses or to the counselor's explanation of the client's personality or behavior. The term self-actualization is derived from the human potential movement. It refers to the tendency of all human beings to move forward, grow, and reach their fullest potential. When humans move towards self-actualization, they are also pro-social, that is, they tend to be concerned for others and behave in honest, dependable, and constructive ways. The concept of self-actualization focuses on human strengths rather than human deficiencies. According to Rogers, self-actualization can be blocked by an unhealthy self-concept. Rogers adopted terms such as person-centered approach and way of behaving and began to focus on personal growth and self-actualization. He also pioneered the use of encounter groups, adopting the sensitivity training, otherwise it is known as T-group, methods developed by Kurt Lewin and other researchers at the National Training Laboratories in the 1950s. Person-centered therapy is considered one of the major therapeutic approaches along with psychoanalytic and cognitive behavioral therapy. Rogers' influence is felt in schools of therapy other than his own. The concepts and methods he developed are used in an eclectic fashion by many different types of counselors and therapists. Now we will see what is the therapeutic process. The goals of person-centered therapy are different from those of traditional approaches. The person-centered therapy aims toward a greater degree of independence and integration of the individual. Its focus is on the person, not on the person's presenting problem. The aim of the therapy is not merely to solve problems, rather it is to assist clients in their growth process so that they can better cope with problems they are now facing and with future problems. Rogers describes people who are becoming increasingly actualized as having, first, an openness to experience, second, a trust in themselves, third, an internal source of evaluation, fourth, a willingness to continue growing. Now we'll see what is the relationship between the therapist and client. According to Rogers, the necessary and sufficient conditions for personality change to occur are: two people are in psychological contact, the client must be experiencing incongruence or anxiety, the counselor should be congruent or having integrated relationship, the counselor experiences unconditional positive regard and acceptance for the client, the counselor experiences an empathic understanding of the client's internal frame of reference and communicate the experience to the client. The next point is the communication to the client by the counselor's empathic understanding and acceptance should be achieved to the minimal degree. Three personal attitudes of the counselor form a central part of the therapeutic relationship. First, congruence or genuineness. Second, unconditional positive regard and acceptance. Third, accurate empathic understanding. Now we'll see what is congruence or genuineness. Congruence implies that counselors are real, that is, they are genuine, integrated, and authentic during the therapy hour. They were without a false front, their inner experience and outer expression of the experience match, and they can openly express feelings, thoughts, reactions, and attitudes that are present in the relationship with the client. Now we'll see what is unconditional positive regard. The counselor needs to communicate to the client the deep and genuine caring. The caring should be unconditional. It is not contaminated by evaluating or judgment of the client's feelings, thoughts, and behavior as good or bad. It is important that the counselor caring must be non-possessive. We will see what is accurate empathic understanding. One of the main tasks of the counselor is to understand the client's experience and feelings sensitively and accurately as they are revealed in the moment-to-moment interaction during the therapy session. The counselor strives to sense client's subjective experience, particularly in the here and now. The aim is to encourage clients to get closer to themselves, feel more deeply and intensely, and to recognize and solve the incongruity that exists within them. We will see what is the techniques of non-directive counseling. In the non-directive counseling framework, the techniques are listening, accepting, respecting, understanding, and responding. We will see what is the role of assessment. In non-directive counseling, does not give importance for psychological testing, rather than they give lot of importance for the clients. Self-assessment. If the client is insisted to be assessed by the battery of psychological tests, then they will be administered by the psychological test to satisfy their request. Areas of application. Non-directive counseling is especially applicable for crisis intervention such as unwanted pregnancy, illness, or loss of loved ones. Basic assumptions of non-directive counseling. The first point is tendency towards actualization. Roger emphasized that the client growth and developmental capacity is that person's characteristics on which the methods of counseling and psychotherapy depend. Even after so many years, his opinion got strength that a person's inherent tendency includes growth, adjustment, socialization, freedom, etc. This directional tendency is termed as actualizing tendency. Second point, belief in the dignity of man. He considers the person capable of taking decisions and he accepts his right to do so. Third point, man is trustworthy. Rogers considers the person basically good and reliable. He also knows that the person behaves in an unreliable manner too. A person is born with some urges which must be controlled if healthy personality development is desired. Fourth point, man is wiser than his intellect. When some organization is functioning independently and effectively, then the awareness is very small part or component of the entire process. When the organization feels some difficulty in its system of functioning, this awareness becomes more sharpened and focused. According to Sinder, the assumption of non-directive counseling are the client has right to select the goals of his life. If the client is given an opportunity, he will select the goals which may possibly provide him great happiness. Third point, emotional disturbances inhibits a person's proper adjustment initially. Fourth point, in the counseling situation, one should reach very quickly at a point from where the client may be able to start functioning independently. The steps involved in non-directive counseling. Carl Rogers proposed the steps for non-directive counseling. They are, first, defining the problematic situation. Second, free expression of feelings. Third, development of insight. Fourth, classification of positive and negative feelings. Fifth, termination of counseling. Now we will see characteristics of non-directive counseling. It is a client-centered counseling. Second, it is based on the principle that the client has so much capacity and drive that will help him to grow to face the situations in reality. Third, the counselor is passive to the maximum. Four, it reduces psychological tensions. Five, defensiveness falls down. Six, there will be closeness between the picture of the self drawn by the client and a desirable and an ideal picture of his own. Seven, client's psychological adjustment improves. Eight, client's behavior is considered to be emotionally matured. Nine, client is accepted for his originality and is free to express his attitude. Axlins proved that the reading improvement speeds up as a result of client-centered playway method in the primary schools, even if special reading instructions are not given. This school of thought is just reverse to that of directive counseling. Now we will see what is the advantages of non-directive counseling. The therapy concentrates on here and now and encourages the client to think in the present time. Second, it recognizes and values the client. Third, it encourages self-expression, self-awareness, self-development, and a greater understanding of self. Now, we will see the conclusion. The counseling can be given to individuals who seek remedy for their problems. Those people who do not seek remedy may not be given counseling. In these circumstances, those who seek remedy can be given directive counseling because there is willingness at their part that can be committed as commitment. Execute the directive counseling suggestion given to the individuals. Whereas in non-directive counseling, the individuals are made to take their own decisions, will somehow or the other try to execute and stick on to the commitment they have made. Therefore, non-directive counseling will have more voluntary involvement on the part of the individuals than the people who have given directive counseling. Therefore, non-directive counseling should be encouraged rather than directive counseling may not work at all times, but unless there is a need for compliance. Thank you.